Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Peeling the Onion, written by Wendy Orr and read by Kate Hosking. The dedication reads, "For my family and all my friends, the ones who stuck by me and the ones I met along the way." Chapter 1. I've won. I'm tingling with energy and excitement, bowing to the judges, accepting. It's the first tournament on the way to the Nationals, and I've just fought last year's champion. And the golden figure on its black marble stand is mine. A two-fingered whistle splits the silence. Hayden is waving his fists in the air and shouting my name. I step back into the crowd and his arms go around me. The kiss is long and fantastic, and I don't think we can say we're just friends anymore. "Save it for the bedroom, you two," Sensei growls, but I'm too happy to be embarrassed. A star of shattered glass cold against my temple. Blackness. Sinking in the woolly blackness, choking, drowning, suffocating. I want to claw my way out but can't move. Want to scream but don't know how. The blackness is swallowing me, and I know that if I can't fight it, the me will be gone and the blackness will go on without end. Strapped on a bed, hard, jolting, pain jabbing, throbbing, screaming. A woman looming over me, smiling. Blue uniform, an ambulance. How's the pain? Past pain into a new dimension of horror. Neck shredded, strangled, spasms from hell. Something over my face, I can't talk. Have to tell her, make her understand, make her fix it. Squeeze my fist in the air tightly and rhythmically, desperately. I can't take much more, my fist screams. The woman smiles. Not too bad? A nightmare. It has to be a nightmare. But even in a nightmare, I'd never make an ambulance so uncomfortable. This must be real. The ambulance stops. A mask is pulled off my face. My bed bumps out into fresh air, rolls through swinging plastic doors and past my parents. They're huddled together, cold and shrunken. I fade out again. Open my eyes to a busy, clattering room with white ceilings, an invisible child crying. Faces hover, white coats and nurses. Deft strokes and sharp knives skin me from t-shirt and jeans. New jeans. I'd have worn old ones if I'd known. My tulip t-shirt, Aunt Lika scented from Holland. Did I say that out loud? We'll save the motive if you want. You could soak out the blood and stitch it onto something else. Must have.
It doesn't matter.
I remember now. Lika's dead. Maybe it wasn't a lucky t-shirt. A sheet draped over me, a doctor dabbing something on my cheek. You were lucky. A little higher and you could have lost an eye. 3 stitches. They'll dissolve in a few days. Now, how do you feel about cleft chins? Don't let him see the panic.
Just what I always wanted.
That's the spirit. This will taste funny. Bitter liquid straight into my mouth from a hole in my chin. Hole through my chin? Sounds yuck. Don't care. Mum and Dad again. Dad sniffs, blows his nose. Crying. A huge, terrible knowledge lurks under the pain, under this babble of words flowing through my brain or out of my mouth.
Is this real?
I ask. Nobody answers. The young doctor wants to know who and where I am, what day it is. The same questions they ask when you're hit in the head at karate. Can't trick me. I'll answer their questions. I'll be polite. They won't let you fight if you don't. Now a torch, bright as a laser beam into my eyes, makes me squeal. Smash it away! Stop myself just in time.
X-rays, he orders.
Wheeled into another room.
Lie still.
What do they think I'm going to do? Jump up and dance? I don't ever want to move again. Back to the noisy bright room, like a casualty ward on a TV soapy. I'm not supposed to be here. The child is still crying. So are my parents, with sniffs and angry wipes at their eyes. Smiling faces. Whiplash, not a broken neck. Doesn't broken neck mean dead? Pain slivers thought. Broken thumb, but ankles only sprained. Torn ligaments, chips of bone, not serious. One doesn't even deserve an x-ray. Now Hayden's here with a nurse behind him and someone who must be his mum. His face is whitish-grey. He has blood in his hair, on his shirt. Anna, I'm so sorry, he says and starts to cry. I don't want him to cry. It's all too hard.
It's not your fault,
I tell him and close my eyes. Chapter 2. I wake in a bed littered with glass. It's morning, a hospital ward. I'm wearing a foam rubber collar and I'm surrounded by old ladies. The one in the bed by the window is so old that she's only semi-conscious. I hope she doesn't die today. The others are old but awake. Mrs. Hogan is beside me, and in the bed across is Ruby. I try to sit up. I can't. I'm anchored to the bed by pain. I try again and yelp like a trodden-on puppy. God, this is so humiliating. A girl appears. Fiona, her name badge says. Student nurse. I'm supposed to do your neurological obs. She studies the slip of paper in her palm. Are you alert and orientated? Alert enough to know I'm desperate for the toilet. Yes. A torch waves like a question mark. I have to look at your eyes. You're not flashing that in my face again. Shine it on the ceiling and watch me look at it. She obeys gratefully. Pushing my luck, I ask if she can help me to the toilet. She says she doesn't know. She'll have to ask someone. Disappears and doesn't come back. Peeing must be next week's lesson. Next is sister in charge of tablets. She clanks with keys and I think she'll be high enough to know about bladders. Too high, she's gone right past. The trolley can't be left alone, she says. It's not alive, Ruby mutters. It won't escape. Tablet sister ignores her. Do I want something for pain? Of course I do. Arsenic, heroin, I don't care, I'll swallow a handful. Please, I say, but I still need to use the toilet. Another nurse comes, but this is worse. She's got a bedpan. She can't be serious. I can't use that. It's disgusting. Please let me go to the toilet. She says I'm not allowed out of bed. It's this or nothing. She's sliding the pan towards my bottom. My right hand is the only part of me not injured, but somehow I have to lift my hips and hop on top, lying down. My neck shrieks. So do I. The nurse is not amused. If you just relax, she snaps, it wouldn't hurt so much. She bustles off to bully some other new inmate.
Busy butt, says Ruby. Look at the way she flaps it. Thinks she rules the world.
That wasn't the way I thought old ladies talked. Suddenly the curtain between my bed and Mrs. Hogan's is whipped shut and the sheet is whisked off my legs. A short, stout, grey man leading a crowd of white coats gives me an I'm too busy for you glance and reaches for the clipboard at the foot of my bed. I'm wearing a short, backless nightgown designed by a pervert. I feel as naked as I am. Hello, I say. But only the young doctor from casualty gives me a quick smile before launching into a coded speech to his big boss, the small grey man. MVA last night, I pick out from the medico babble. 17 years old, closed head injury, soft tissue injuries to the neck.
X-ray, barks the god.
Yes, says the young one as he spouts off another mind-numbing stream of gibberish. It sounds impressive. It doesn't sound like me. 17 years old is the only thing I understand, and I wish he'd stopped there. Now it's Tablet Sister's turn. She discusses my pain and how I slept. The pain has nothing to do with me, apparently. Don't mind me, I'm just the body that owns it. I lie there, legs pressed tight together and my good hand clutching my nightie, as quiet and still as the dummy they want me to be. Suddenly the sheet is whipped back up to neatness. The group turns to Mrs. Hogan and I'm invisible again.
How could this happen to me? Things like this only happen to other people. That's how I know it's not real. Mum's here. I'm surprised by how glad I am to see her, clinging to her as fiercely and desperately as a child. She unpacks a bag, a dressing gown, her new blue nightie, toothbrush and hairbrush, deodorant and talc. No mirror. She flusters, says she's lost her compact. Delicately, tenderly, she begins to comb my hair. Half a windscreen seems to be tangled through it, embedded in every strand of my falling out braid. The shards plink into the bag taped to the side of my bed. Mum's fingers probe and smooth. She's still at it when Dad arrives with Bronnie and Matt. They hang back, twisting awkward feet at the end of my bed, while Dad tiptoes up and kisses me gingerly. "Come on," he says. "Show Anna what you've got for her." Drawings. Bronnie's is a card with flowers and a black and white cat I recognise as Sally. "Get well" printed neatly inside. Matthew's is, "You in the ambulance," he explains, "and that's the car all smashed." "Oh, Matt," says Mum, and "Sorry," says Dad, "oh, I should have checked." Bronwyn is turning green. Mum grabs her quickly and drags her out to the corridor. "It's a bit hot in there," she calls. But I can hear Bronnie wailing.
"I couldn't even tell it was Anna."
Dad asks quickly if I've seen the doctor. I describe the ward round. Dad erupts, my placid father, incandescent in white rage.
"Tell this cowboy!"
Matt pipes up. "Are there cowboys in hospital?" "No," I say, and thank God it's time for Dad to take them to school. Mum will stay a little longer, all day if I like, but I know that's impossible. She'd have to close the nursery. I say I'd rather sleep. Dad asks if I know his work number. Of course I don't. I never ring him at work. He hands over his card. "Peter Duncan, chartered accountant. Will come as soon as I need him. Cancel appointments to be here in a moment." Come on, God, what have I done to deserve this? If you want to kill me, do it quickly. Punch my teeth out, one by one. Pry my fingernails off with rusty nails. Anything but this. This has gone right off the borders of pain and into another galaxy. I can't take it. Painkillers bring me back to Earth. I'm propped up in bed on an arrangement of pillows when Hayden appears, looking even taller than usual, broad shoulders and big hands awkward in this sterile environment. I feel breathless at the sight of him. My hands are shaky, my heart pounding. I've never felt this way about anyone before. He's brought me a bunch of white carnations. They're not much compared to all those. He gestures to the perfect cellophane-covered arrangements which have poured in during the day. From the school, the karate club, Aunt Jackie in Perth, Oma and Opar in Holland. Oh, I didn't know if you'd even want to talk to me. It wasn't your fault. And everyone says I'll be right in a couple of weeks. It's no big deal. You weren't there, he says, illogically but truly, and corrects himself. You don't know what it was like. I can still hear you screaming. Then I thought you were dead. We jimmied the door off and tried to lift you out, but you grabbed your neck and screamed again, and we stopped till the ambulance came. I try to remember, but it's someone else's story. No memory surfaces. Dad comes in early next morning to catch the ward round. He wants to know whether I should be transferred to a Melbourne hospital for specialised care. Mr. Osman, the great orthopaedic god, is not impressed.
Yarralong District Hospital, he snaps condescendingly, is well equipped to deal with your daughter's injuries.
He goes on to explain the plan for the day. My thumb needs an operation. It's in 11 pieces. He is going to try to screw it together. I don't want a general anaesthetic. I've seen GP and documentaries. I know it will hurt my neck. I don't think I'll live if the pain gets worse. He promises an arm block, and Dad signs the consent forms. I feel so old, but I'm not old enough to sign my own name. A few hours later, the anaesthetist pumps me full of Valium till I'm floating and witty. Except that my brain's lost contact with my body, so my mouth doesn't work. Alex, the young doctor, returns in the afternoon when everything's reconnected itself. He's gorgeous, I've just noticed. This is not how I want to meet gorgeous men. The operation is a success. The long bone of my thumb has been screwed neatly back together again. You'll make metal detectors scream. I smile because he is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.